When you're made homeless by a natural disaster, what support is there when you lose everything? The residents of Muriwai, left devastated by Cyclone Gabrielle 6 months ago, are feeling alone and losing hope. The small community on Auckland's west coast was cut through by massive slips that destroyed everything in their path and left it isolated for months. Mark Kreisel is with them as they ask, what next? And could this deadly tragedy have been avoided?
What happened on the night of Gabrielle?
I can feel my heart racing.
When did it really hit home for you, Amalia?
I think when I heard Mum say our house is gone.
I've never seen anything like it. The water, the wind, it was out of this world.
On the eve of Valentine's Day, 2023,
I saw a fireman in my garden. He said, I think it's a good idea that you leave. We weren't too scared at that stage, but that's when we left our house.
There were just rivers of water. There was mud everywhere.
At what stage did you become scared?
That would be after one of the houses in our street had fully collapsed.
There were trees down across the road. There were broken power lines.
The earth had moved. Massive landslides rolled down Muriwai's steep cliffs. More houses were crushed. Two firefighters died.
Someone came down in a Land Rover Discovery and picked us up to ferry us up to the surf club. And the water came up to the windows. And there would have been, by my estimate, a couple of hundred people sitting downstairs. There were elderly people, kids, babies, dogs, cats, and we're all just in a state of shock.
Some of those people have never returned to their homes. Some never will. 3 months on from Cyclone Gabrielle, Muriwai is cordoned off to non-locals.
Hi.
How are you going?
We're from TVNZ. Can we go in and do some filming today?
Rain's threatening again. The land's already saturated and dangerous. The answer is no. As we turn back, it starts to fall. It's another 2 days before it's safe enough to go in. The cleanup's still going, and we're the first crew invited to film behind the cordon. It's a shock.
Everywhere you look is just utter devastation, and the closer you look, the more you see. This is the driveway, and this is the house that it once led to.
Fragments of life preserved in mud, glimpses of a community that once was.
This is a beautiful community. There's always someone here to put flowers in your letterbox or drop off a batch of muffins. It's the little toots and the waves and the yowls when you're going past, and yeah.
We meet Charlotte Reynolds at the local surf club. We can't go to her house. This is safe ground. Charlotte used to live at the foot of that steep hill with her husband, Baldev, and their daughter, Amalia.
So an old beach batch that had been tinkered around with a wee bit. We've got a fantastic builder, and a lot of local tradies have put a lot of time into it.
Baldev died suddenly 6 years ago. The house became Amalia and Charlotte's sanctuary. Then, Gabrielle struck.
What did you leave with?
My daughter, my dogs, my husband's ashes, and my book, can you believe it? I thought I'd probably just be out of the house for the night.
How and when did you find out about the damage to your house?
I found out from the TV.
Charlotte and Amalia haven't been allowed back inside since.
Most people, when I say we're never coming home, they're like, I thought it was just a storm. It certainly wasn't a storm. I've got a pine tree through the middle of my house.
We put our drone up. This is the first time they have seen the damage up close.
Look at the size of the branches on there, though. Look at the pine tree. That's huge. There's our barbecue still sitting there. Look at that mud on it. Oh, man.
The house is red stickered, deemed by council as too dangerous to enter.
What do you miss?
My bed, my pillow.
When you walk away with nothing and you can't return, that means that you've got no clothes, you've got no paperwork, you've got no spices in the cupboard. You're starting from scratch.
But some things you can't replace.
Kids' drawings on the fridge, photos of my grandparents and the Christmas ornaments from kindy. I want to take everything.
More than 100 Muriwai properties are red stickered. Home for their occupants, now where they find it.
Lachlan.
Oh, hi, Mark.
Home sweet home?
Yeah, home sweet home. Good to see you.
No, don't, actually.
Oh, sorry, hands are a bit wet.
So, this is it.
This is it. This is our home.
Lachlan McKinven's living in a caravan.
For the first 3 months, we had no fridge, no running water, and no hot water.
In the middle of winter,
I've given up wearing normal shoes. I just wear gumboots because you step out, you know, into the mud a lot of the time. Not really looking forward to the next few months of cold and rain.
Sharing the only bed with a five-year-old, his daughter Charlotte.
I do often wake up with a foot in my chin.
Lachlan feels this is his only choice.
I think with the average rent in this area, the insurance money that is available to us would probably only last 3 or 4 months.
It's cheaper to live in a caravan.
It is cheaper. Our mortgage is more than half my income each week. If we could have mortgage relief, we could afford to rent suitable accommodation.
This is where Lachlan and Charlotte used to live.
As a solo father, I had to scrape every cent that I could together, call in favours from friends. I mean, it still seems like a miracle to me today that we actually managed to buy that house. But we did it, and I think it's the happiest we've ever been being here. We love lighting the fire in winter, and we've got a vegetable garden, a fenced yard, which meant we were able to get a puppy. That's our house, it's our home.
It now stands undamaged, but abandoned.
The land is not damaged either.
It's the neighbouring slips that pose too much of a risk. Lachlan hasn't been allowed inside since February. He was finally given access to his house this month for just 2 hours.
Things were pretty much as we left them, sort of frozen in time, although through the kitchen window, a vine had grown maybe a metre long over the kitchen sink. It's incredible to see how quickly nature moves in when we move out.
Lachlan is in limbo.
Do you feel like you're forgotten?
I do feel like we've been forgotten. I've paid a third of my income in tax all my life, but then you wake up one morning and it doesn't feel like there's a safety net there at all.
He knows it will take time for the stability of the land to be assessed, but Charlotte needs a proper home.
Are you warm enough?
And going home can feel like a long way away.
How do you explain all this to a five-year-old?
A few weeks ago, we were driving down to the campground and she reached out and took my hand and looked at me and said, "Dad, I really want to go back to our home now. I just really want to go home. It's tough." Be careful. I try to be optimistic. I squeeze her hand and say, "Hopefully we can soon, darling, hopefully."
Coming up, a community on the edge.
There's people in our community that have suffered heart attacks.
And have we learned the lessons of history?
Do you think that people should have been allowed to rebuild there?
No, I don't. It was a big mistake.
It's the last weekend in June. Muriwai is once again open for visitors. But not everyone is happy about it.
We hope that the majority of people are just coming out to have a beautiful walk on the beach or a midwinter swim. But we also know that we're very, very vulnerable. We can't go in to secure our homes because we're not allowed in our homes.
Yeah. Charlotte and Amalia haven't been allowed to go home since Gabrielle struck.
There's been some government support in terms of a service called Temporary Accommodation Service. They offered me a place in the city, but you can't take your animals.
It affects us just as much as it affects you, so.
Oh, are you gonna play that card?
Well, I've got you living here.
Exactly.
So they and their dogs have been taken in by their local builder and his whānau.
Is this the same builder that worked on your house?
It is the same builder that worked on my house. Open arms, amazing. this is going to happen in other places too. It's not just here.
Yeah, coming to a town near
yeah.
you.
I think it's been really good for the company, because I think if we'd been on our own, we would have completely spiralled.
But Charlotte knows they can't stay forever.
You can't leave this house until my puzzle's done.
Oh, my God.
We're never going to leave it.
How long can you stay with your builder?
We should have gone weeks ago. We should have gone weeks ago.
Earlier in the month, the government committed to a voluntary buyout co-funded by local councils of the most damaged properties. But a follow-up email left Charlotte feeling no further ahead.
So they've asked for a little bit more information, and one of the funny questions is, how big is the slip behind you? Is it like the size of a bus or a container ship? And if you look behind me, you can see all the way up to the skyline. It's definitely the size of a container ship.
Complicating Charlotte's situation is a controversial piece of building legislation.
It was deregulation. It did have a big impact.
By law, councils are required to issue building consents for land at risk of natural hazards, as long as it doesn't increase the risks. It must be noted on the property title and also absolves councils of any civil liability. This affects thousands of properties across Auckland alone, including Muriwai.
Would you live there?
Not at the foot of the escarpment.
Martin Brook is an associate professor of applied geology at Auckland University. He says Muriwai's weak sandy soils and steep cliffs add up to a long, dark history of landslides.
The L's are all former landslides, prehistoric landslides. We've got bedrock, and we've got all this weak sand on top of that bedrock, and when that weak sand gets saturated, it's going to flow.
Dr. Brook has developed these slides showing how Muriwai continued to build houses on land that was historically subject to slips.
They move up metres per second, which is very rapid, and it's really impossible to get out of the way.
In 1965, massive landslides destroyed two batches. A mother and daughter died.
1969 April, so 4 years after the 1965 landslides. We've got the outline here of the 65 landslides. The houses have gone. In fact, the council engineer had said there's not going to be any more rebuilding on this site, and there wasn't for several years.
But by the 1980s, the law had loosened up to allow more houses to be built.
The key thing was the 1981 Local Government Amendment Act. And what that meant was that it was more difficult for councils to stop building on unstable land. And here we are, late 1980s, more and more houses getting built within the footprint of the 1965 fatal landslides.
Do you think that people should have been allowed to rebuild there?
No, I don't. It was a big mistake. And I think a student who's done Geology 101 would probably question that. It's a known landslide hazard area. It doesn't really get any higher risk than this.
The deadly legacy of that law change, houses built in the path of this year's landslides.
The white line is the rough outline of the 2023 landslides at this end of Domain Crescent. You can see there's quite a coincidence between the 1965 landslide footprint in yellow and the 2023 landslides in white.
Have we learned the lessons of history?
No. We did for a decade and a half, and then we forgot. Land is expensive in New Zealand, so developers want to develop land and make money. A lot of councils want to increase their rateable base as well. So there's always pressure on land development. The more and more it's in more marginal greenfield areas.
Dr. Brook has a stark warning.
Everyone gets a building report done when they buy a house and get a mortgage. You really need to get a landscape report done as well.
Charlotte's house is on Domain Crescent. It had a notice on the title when she bought it in 2006.
What do you say to those who say, buyer beware?
I totally can understand that point of view, but you're also there seeking advice, and the experts have said that it's somewhere to build and to live.
But the danger is, insurance may not pay out on her land.
It would be really unfair if we had that situation again for someone else. You don't want anyone to go through what we're going through.
Today, this community is coming together. The meeting gets underway. It's standing room only. The then Minister for Auckland, Michael Wood, fronts the crowd.
I know you have amongst the largest number of severely affected homes in one place.
There's a mix of hope and disbelief.
We don't kind of have a specific rule book for how we do this.
Mike Hibbert.
We are running out of money in the next few weeks.
Is the chair of the Muriwai Stickered Residents Group.
The average rents are around $800 a week. So we're a little bit surprised that you're just starting to work this out with the relevant ministers.
There's a role here for government, and I think there is a role here for the banks as well.
What we have is a mental health issue. There's people in our community that have suffered heart attacks.
Lachlan McKinvin is also feeling the stress. His house is undamaged, but he still can't go home.
I'm so tired. I feel so tired all the time. And you start to wonder, how long can a person go on like this? I don't want to get to breaking point.
Afterwards, a bit of kai.
Oh, okay.
A few drinks.
Corona and a Pinot 15.
And reality bites.
The more complex cases which involve remediation could take years.
Yeah.
That was the first time we heard years.
Paid our rates, paid our insurance. It's not having the information that's really heartbreaking. Do I take a lease on a flat for a year? Do I go overseas? What do I do?
For 6 months, Charlotte has called the spare bedroom home.
This was a donated one from someone in the neighbourhood.
However, it's time to move on.
So a few more things that we've just got to sort out for the kitchen.
Bathroom, I need
glam wrap. Soap.
They're hoping for a fresh start, but there's bad news.
The insurance company have told me that EQC are declining to pay the land value. The insurance company will still cover the house, but the land value now comes off the house value. So I pay for the land, basically.
What's your best hope now?
We have a fair and equitable buyout process that gets decided really quickly because we've got to get people out of this trauma.
What did you like most about that house?
Oh, just its heart. It was such a warm... Don't you're going to make me cry. Just such a warm, beautiful house. And it was really important to me to have a gorgeous place for my daughter to grow up in so that she was felt safe.
Does it feel safe now?
No, it does not feel safe. No.
So this is the reality of campground living.
From next month, residents can apply for a weekly allowance based on the average rent for their area.
You need to have a rental contract.
And Lachlan doesn't.
I've chosen to live in a caravan to cut costs, and I know of other people who have just gone to live with family to save money. It should just be a payment with no strings attached to people who have lost their houses.
Even if he was eligible, Lachlan says it's not enough.
The amount that I was going to be offered as a solo father with one child is not actually enough to rent a house in this area. I mean, how can you be put out of your house onto the street overnight for a parent with a five-year-old child? What are you supposed to do?
How much longer can you hang on in a caravan?
My daughter and I have had more sickness this winter than any winter in my memory. It's been really, really tough. And I have to say now it just feels 50-50 really, whether we'll be going home or never going home.
No allowance. No specific details on how a buyout will work.
You all right, Sha?
Yeah.
Have we learnt the lessons of Christchurch?
I don't think so. It seems that we weren't really prepared at all.
That's not the dinosaur.
Will Muriwai ever be the same again?
Many people say it won't unless the council can bring up more land in this area to build on. I don't see how we can keep the whole community together. It's really sad.
Well, most of Muriwai's affected residents will find out tomorrow which risk category their property falls into. We'll keep you updated on Charlotte and Lachlan's progress. And this week also marks the anniversary of the 1965 landslides at Muriwai. To those who lost loved ones in both events, kei te mihi aroha.